Anyway, let's hear it for Arlo Guthrie and his band. Arlo Guthrie.
You know me. changing cars in Memphis, Tennessee. Halfway home and we'll be there by morning. Through the Mississippi darkness, rolling down to the sea. But all the towns and people seem to fade into a bad dream. The steel rail still ain't heard the news. The conductor sings his songs again. The passengers will please refrain. This train got the disappearing railroad blues.
I remember I was standing on the Farm Aid stage not too long ago, and I remember singing this song, this last one, and it's still one of my favorite songs, I tell you. Even though I knew I had to go to the Farm Aid thing, though, not just because it was a good idea, but, well, because I knew I was one of the few people left in the, you know, country that, the only one probably that hadn't sung a duet with Willie Nelson. So, wouldn't took care of that. Around that same time, I wrote my own farm song. I wrote it to the tune of my favoriteest farm song tune of all time, Old MacDonald. It's not like a brilliant song or nothing, but I thought, well, I didn't get a chance to sing it there, so I thought I'd sing it here. It goes something like this. This is what you want to do if you want to get in the farm business today. Maybe. First you runs down to the banks, and you gets yourself a loan. For $80,000 cash, you can drive that tractor home. You can drive all night, you can drive all day. You can drive over everything getting in your way. And you ain't gotta worry till the payback day, down on the American farm. So you get some stuff and you spread it around, to keep the bugs and the animals down. And you spray it on the crops and you pump it in the ground. But the bugs get bigger and it attacks the folks in town. You can spray all day, you can spray all night, but the bugs get bigger and they ain't afraid to fight. You can drive all night, you can drive all day, you can drive over everything getting in your way. And you still ain't gotta worry till the payback day, down on the American farm. So pretty soon the stuff comes up, you goes to cut it down. You put it in a pickup truck and hauls it all to town. But the more you grow and the more you spend, the less it's worth to the market in the end. You can drive all night, work, spray all day. Wait, I always get that confused. You can spray all night. Yo, wait, start again. You can spray all day, spray all night, but the bugs get bigger and they ain't afraid to fight. You can drive all night, drive all day, drive over everything getting in your way. And now it's driving you crazy, cause you can't afford to stay down on the American farm. Check. Not only that, it's going this way too. I got it straightened out. Look at this thing. Oh, I know. It's when it started taking off, going around. It went, you know, like that. I was thinking about farms and stuff, because we were just, well, in a bunch of farm country. You know, back 40 years ago when my dad was writing some of these kinds of farm songs and stuff, things was even worse than they are now. It's hard to believe, but it's true, because not only did they have banks back then, but they used to have, like, storms, too. Storms would come and take all the topsoil off of one guy's farm and dump it over on the next guy's. Which wasn't so bad, I guess, you know, if you was, well, just the next guy. But that same storm take both of their farms and dump it over on the third guy's place. And theirs on the fourth. And you, well, you can imagine how it'd be 1,000 farms down the road. Kids, houses, trees, trucks, everything getting buried. Nobody could farm no more, so a lot of them left. A lot of them come out this way. Banks come in. And if that wasn't bad enough, they had outlaws, too. One of those outlaws was a guy by the name of Pretty Boy Floyd. He still gets a hand, huh? I guess even back then, sort of people liked him. Well, although no one really considered him to be exactly, you know, like a philanthropist. There were a lot of people that didn't consider him to be exactly like an outlaw. In the sense that, well, he was redistributing farms in the form of cash throughout a lot of the countryside. People got to like him and they wrote songs about him. And my dad wrote one, and I still sing it today, 40 years later, because sometimes it's still hard to tell the difference between the policies of a politician and the policies of an outlaw. If you gather around me, children, this story I will tell about Pretty Boy Floyd the outlaw. Oklahoma knew him well. It was in the town. Tippity shade of the brush film, any man who read the room, using all the words and language, it is what you overheard. Pretty Boy red log chain, and the deputy grabbed his gun, and in the fight that followed, he laid that deputy down. He took to the trees and timber. And he lived a life of shame. Every crime in Oklahoma was added to his name. You know, he took to the trees and timbers on the Canadian River shore. But the outlaw found a welcome at many a farmer's door. You know, there's many a starving farmer, yes, the same old story told. The outlaw paid their mortgage and saved their little home. And others tell you of a stranger who had come to beg a meal, and underneath his napkin left $1,000 bill. It was in Oklahoma City, yes, it was on a Christmas day. Come a whole carload of groceries with a letter that did say, you say that I'm an outlaw. Yes, you say that I'm a thief. Well, here's a Christmas dinner for the families on relief. You know, it's through this world I've rambled. I've seen lots of funny men. Some will rob you with a six gun, and some with a fountain pen. But it's through your life you ramble, yes, and it's through your life you roam. You won't ever see an outlaw drive a family from their home. I guess some men are outlaws because of what they do. And some men are outlaws because of what they think and what they have to say. And this is a song about somebody like that. 50 Hunter of Chile lived like a shooting star. He fought for the people of Chile with his songs and his guitar. His hands were gentle, his hands were strong. Victor Jara was a peasant, worked from a few years old. He sat upon his father's plow and watched the earth unfold. His hands were gentle, his hands were strong. Now when the neighbors had a wedding, oh, one of their children died. His mother sang all night for them with Victor by her side. His hands were gentle, his hands were strong. He grew up to be a fighter against the people's wrongs. He listened to their grief and joys and turned them into songs. His hands were gentle, his hands were strong. He sang about the copper miners and those who worked the land. He sang about the factory workers, and they knew he was their man. His hands were gentle, his hands were strong. Then the generals seized Chile. They arrested Victor then. They caged him in a stadium with 5,000 frightened men. His hands were gentle, his hands were strong. Victor stood in the stadium. His voice was brave and strong, and he sang for his fellow prisoners till the guards cut short his song. His hands were gentle, his hands were strong. They broke the bones in both his hands, they beat him on the head, they tore him with electric shocks, and then he shot him dead. His hands were gentle, his hands were strong. Victor Jara of Chile lived like a shooting star. He fought for the people of Chile with his songs and his guitar. His hands were gentle, his hands were strong. His hands were gentle, his hands were strong. Thank you. gonna leave here right here, 'cause walking just too slow. I'm getting up early, early in the morning, and I'm gonna put on my walking shoes. When the leather hits the highway, Lord, I'm gonna lose my walking blues. Things in the world give you the blues sometimes. Matter of fact, when we started on this tour, it was back in like February. That's enough to get you feeling strange, but one of the places we were playing was down in Florida, and when we got down there, we found something really interesting, because I don't get to watch TV all the time because we're always singing and stuff, so I didn't know what was going on down there. But there were so many people working for the federal government in Florida, guarding like the borders and stuff, making sure that illegal substances aren't coming into America, that I couldn't tell if I was having one of those chromosome damage flashbacks you're supposed to get or what. I couldn't tell if I was there then or 20 years ago. And I felt like, well, I knew a lot of the narcs and stuff would be at the show, you know, and because they got to go do stuff when the night's off and things, and I wanted to, well, I wanted to thank them. Not so much for my Garden America and stuff, but just because a lot of those, especially the young narcs, don't realize that I got my start in this, you know, music thing, mostly on account of people working for the federal government. It was a while ago, so I didn't expect everybody to know that, but, you know, I wanted to tell them, look, when I first started playing, I was playing in little clubs in, like, you know, New York and stuff, and I'd be standing up on the stage, but there'd be nobody in the audience. And I was saying weird things, and I wasn't the only one. There was other people playing to other empty clubs, and they were saying weird things, too. And the government started saying, what are those weird people saying? And they disguised some people up as normal and sent them down to the club. And they were sitting there, and pretty soon the state government started saying, why are people going to hear those weird people? So they dressed some folks up, and they came down, too. And by the time we was done with the federal and the state, the county, local city, and all that stuff, we was back in the joints. And pretty soon, tour buses was coming by filled with people saying, there must be something happening there. Let's go see. Pretty soon, record companies and TVs, newspapers, everybody's coming down there. And I've been going ever since. And I wanted to take an opportunity to thank those people who had, well, I guess at partially my and your expense, had to go and sit through my stuff even as far back as 20 years ago. And I know because a lot of people don't understand the hardship. I mean, what it takes to even be a narc today. It was tough back then, but even now. It's not like you get out of high school and say, well, should I go to college or be a narc? It's something that has to start when you're a little baby. It has to be sort of nurtured and taken care of. It has to be groomed. And it, maybe it's easier today with special ed and stuff, but, you know, it didn't used to be. When you think of people with powers and stuff, I know you could be thinking of some yogi sitting in a cave in India or something, but I know people with powers in this country. People with unbelievable... I met a guy one time, they used to stand him on airport runways, and he would smell airplanes as they was coming in for landing. Not only that, he could pick out a guy and tell you what seat he was in. And he'd call up to the folks at the gate saying, there's a man in 36C, he's carrying some illegal substance. And then they'd pick the poor guy up at the gate. I know you're sitting there saying, that's the stupidest thing I ever heard. What's he talking about up there? I paid for that stuff. I know what I'm talking about. I know because one time I was sitting on an airplane in seat 36C. I was coming into America from a foreign land.
Yeah.
And I had what we used to call illegal substance on my person. I didn't mean to have it. I just couldn't help it because, well, it was so cheap over there. I got on the plane and everything was fine until the plane took off. And I suddenly realized, wait a minute. I can't get out of this plane. And not only that, I was sitting in, you know, the no smoking section. I knew I was in trouble. I started having what we used to call inspiration. We don't call it that. Today we call it paranoia, but back then we used to call that feeling inspiration. And as a matter of fact, I was getting so inspired, it was like turning into like a revelation. Because I could see stuff. I was looking out the window of my plane and I could see that man on the runway 1,000 miles away. And in a desperate fit of inspiration, not knowing what else to do, I ate it. The whole thing. And there I was. Sitting in seat 36C, D, E, and F. I was floating around the airplane. But it was okay, because I knew I had powers. As a matter of fact, the plane was going down one time, but I just put my hand up. I thought, up! And the plane went, okay. I saved everybody's life. I didn't even have to say nothing. They all knew it was me that saved them. It was all looking at me. I remember when the plane landed, because a time tunnel come to meet me. I remember because it was attached to the building, and it come out like that, and attached itself on the plane. And everybody was walking out into the time tunnel. I was watching them disappear. Finally, I said, I am not afraid of time. I got my stuff and walked off into the time tunnel like everybody else. And all of a sudden, standing right in front of me in the time tunnel was the same guy that I had seen in my revelation. The same guy I had seen smelling my plane 1,000 miles away was now standing right in front of me. And he had a look in his eye that said, I know you ate it. But it was okay because I had a look in my eye too. It said, yep.
Feel much time coming into Los Angeles.
its curfew, golden glad. Upon four-legged forest clouds, the cowboy angel rides, with his candle lit into the sun, though its glow is waxed in black. All except beneath the trees of Eden, the lamppost stands with folded arms, its iron claws attached. Two curves neath holes where babies wail through its shadows, metal bashed. All in all, can only fall with a crashing but meaningless blow. No sounds ever come from the gates of Eden. The savage soldier sticks his head into the sand and then complains. Unto the shoeless hunter who's gone deaf but still remains. Upon the beach where hound dogs bay at ships with tattooed sails, headed for the gates of Eden. The time rusted compass blade, Aladdin and his lamp, sits with utopian hermit monks, saddle on the golden cap, and only promises of paradise, you will not hear a laugh. All except inside the gates of Eden. Relationships of ownership, they whisper in the wind. Those condemned to act accordingly and await for succeeding kings. And I try and harmonize with songs the lonesome sparrows sing. And there are no kings inside the gates of Eden. The motorcycle black Madonna, two-wheeled gypsy queen, studded phantom caused the gray flannel dwarf to scream. As he weeps, two wicked birds I pray pick up on his breath from sin. And there are no sins inside the gates of Eden. The kingdoms of experience in the precious wind they rise. While paupers change possessions, each one wishing for what the other has got. The princess and the prince discuss what's real and what's not. It doesn't matter inside the gates of Eden. The fire and the sun, it squints upon a bed that is never mine. As friends and others, strangers from their fates try to resign, leaving men wholly and totally free to do anything they wish to do but die. There are no trials inside the gates of Eden. At dawn, my lover comes to me, tells me of her dreams, with no attempts to shovel a glimpse into the ditch of what each one means. And at times I think there are no words but these to tell what's true. There are no truths outside the gates of Eden.
Thank you.
must be like to be a younger person out here in the audience tonight, being sort of dragged here by an over-enthusiastic peer of mine. Sitting out there, looking up here, saying, boy, what were these folks into? Looking back at the people that brought you, looking back up here, looking back at them, moving away a little bit. You're not alone in the world, though. It's got to be tough growing up anywhere in the world, especially now. Especially if you're trying to grow up in America with parents that grew up during the 60s. I know because I got kids of my own. They say, you know, Dad, you're all right and stuff, but you got to learn to rock and roll and stuff. They want me to wear leather spiky looking things everywhere, too. And they think I'm weird. If you're feeling like that out in the world tonight, this song's for you. Sort of. Prom's just a throwback to the 60s generation. All that junk like peace and love is just an aggravation. Ain't got no use for transcendental meditation. Have been a Virgo or a head shop owner or two freaks from San Francisco or a washed out surfer with his body golden tan or some lead singer in a psychedelic band feeding me granola and other flaky stuff. You told me meat was hostile, but I just can't get enough. Days in Woodstock, half a million space balls, and all of them with their feet stuck, freaking out on acid, and what Bob Dylan says, I think she's trying to turn me into Joan Baez. Oh, Mom, can you tell me where your head's at? Sort of singing that about something else, because I know a lot of people are worried in the world about stuff. You know, people are worried about what's going on in Chernobyl and all that kind of, you know, with the nuke stuff. People have been worried for years about that stuff, not me. But, Because I know they're going to fix... I mean, they're going to take care of stuff. Because they got new inventions. They got even new bugs and stuff now. You read about that? Even 2 years ago, they had bugs. That, you know, the oil spill bugs? You spill a bunch of oil out in the ocean. I could tell you don't know about this. But this is real. I'm not making this stuff up now. You dump a bunch of oil in the ocean, and then you get these bugs. And you dump a can of bugs out into the oil spill, and they eat it. They munch up all the oil and turn it into a little microscopic bug turd. And then when there's no more oil, they all die. And it's okay, because fish eat them. And then you do. I read about that. It's true. And now, you see, just last week I read they got potato bugs now. I mean, a new kind that they just invented that stops potatoes from freezing and stuff. That's some, what they got, little bugs with shovels or something. I don't know. Potatoes look like they're going to freeze. Dump the bugs out. Now go to the bugs and stop them from freezing. If they could have bugs that stops potatoes from freezing and bugs that eats oil spills, how long can it be before they're going to have bugs that eats like little nuke plants and missiles and stuff like that? I can see it in my mind. I can see some middle-aged women out there, you know, standing by the old nuke plant, shouting over the fence, "If you don't do what we want, I'm going to dump these can of bugs out." That scared the hell out of them in there. Boy, talk about terrorism and stuff like that. That terrorized a bunch of people. I could imagine it in my mind. As a matter of fact, I know people even over Europe are getting worried about stuff. They're always worried about something. But I saw, because I was watching TV last week, or it might have been last year. I'm not sure, but I was watching, and the people over in Europe are getting upset about American missiles going over there. And I decided I was going to write a song about it, so I did. And then about 6 months later, well, it must have been a year, I found myself over in Germany, because they had invited me over to sing at one of these big demonstrations they were having. And I went over there. But hey, I really went to straighten them out. And I went over there and I told them. I said, "You don't understand, but we got to have our American missiles here in Germany. Because, well, we can't have them at home. People at home don't want them. Not only that, you know, if we had them at home, we'd never be able to use them. Because then the Russians would be knowing where they're coming from. And then they'd be sending missiles over to us, and they'd bomb us, and we'd die and stuff. So we got to have our American missiles here in Germany." They didn't understand. Probably like a language barrier or something. But I knew I was understood, because it wasn't 3 weeks later, I got a telegram from Ronald Reagan. Really? Said, "Dear Arlo, saw you on the news the other night talking about American foreign policy. And you explained it so clear and so wonderful that, well, even I'm beginning to understand it." Thank you. Inch by inch, row by row, gonna make this garden grow. Gonna mulch it deep and low, gonna make it fertile ground. Inch by inch, row by row, please bless these seeds I sow. Please keep them safe below, till the rain comes tumbling down. Pulling weeds and picking stones, we are made of dreams and bones. Need a place to call my own, cause the time is close at hand. Grain for grain, sun and rain, find my way in nature's chain. Tune my body and my brain to the music of the land. Help us out here. Inch by inch, row by row, gonna make this garden grow. Gonna mulch it deep and low, gonna make it fertile ground. It's not that hard a song. Inch by inch, row by row, please bless these seeds I sow. Please keep them safe below, till the rain comes tumbling down. Plant your row straight and long, the season with a prayer and song. Mother Earth will make you strong, if you give her love and care. Old bro watching from a tree, he's got his hungry eye on me. But in my garden I'm as free as that feather deep up there. Inch by inch, row by row, gonna make this garden grow. Gonna mulch it deep and low. I know you're probably sitting out there saying, why should I be singing along on that Dingleberry folk song anyway? And I understand that because I used to feel that way about this song myself. I learned a song from Pete Seeger. He'd be up singing it and stuff. I'd just be playing along with him, you know. Yeah, that's great, Pete, yeah. I wouldn't be caught singing this song. I used to feel that way up until, last week. It's true. I mean, last week I finally realized, well, I was up in Canada and I was coming back down across the border and they stopped me at Canadian Customs and Immigration. It was really late at night. I can't imagine why they stopped me going out. Coming in, I could see. But going out, I guess they stopped everybody that looks like me. But it was really late at night. I was the only person they stopped and they were going through my papers in the glass booth there and I was sitting in an empty waiting room. And just by accident, I happened to be singing this song to myself. You know, like, inch by inch, row by row, gonna make this garden grow. Guy comes running out the booth. He tapped me on the shoulder and says, excuse me, sir, but what's that you're doing, eh? I looked at the guy. I said, I'm singing a song. He says, I know that, sir, but what language is that song in? I said, what language? It's in American! The guy looked at me with a puzzled face, a quizzled face. I suddenly looked at this guy and realized he's about 20 years old, probably just out of school. This is his first job and stuff. And he didn't know. He didn't know what an inch was. I suddenly realized this was no Dingleberry folk song I was singing. I suddenly realized that this song was about a way of life that's rapidly, this song is about the last spot, the last bastion, the last place where we still have the poetry of mile after mile in our lives and not kilometers after kilometers. I suddenly realized that this was the last place where we had a way of life that's disappearing from the whole world and maybe even the whole universe. I suddenly realized this new way sneaking in. Sneaking in from the northeast, south, and west. Sneaking in when you got to buy pop bottles and plastic liters now. And you got to buy gas the same way. They say it's cheap, how do you know? Sneaking in when kids come home from school doing homework and parents don't even know it's math they're doing. Sneaking in, screwing up our way of life. You know, everybody in the world used to have their own way of counting 30 years ago. Look what's happened to the world in the last 30 years. Screwed up. That's all you can say. And it's beginning to happen here. And people are asking, how come America's getting screwed up? The Congress got a committee. President's got a commission. Everybody's got something. I know why. There's a lot of important things in the world. I sing about some of them. I know. But there's nothing more important than this song. Because the problems of the world can't be solved in meters. The problems of the world can only be solved the way we made them. Inch by inch. And mile after mile. So when you hear this song, don't be thinking it's some dingleberry folk song. You got to sing along on this song. You got to learn the words. If you're from a foreign country or something here tonight, just learn inch by inch. You could save a nation. Because if you don't, somebody could be sitting on this stage 1 year from now, and everybody be sitting out in the audience thinking it's one of those foreign folk songs that Pete always sings. So here we go now. Inch by inch, row by row, gonna make this garden grow. Gonna mulch it deep and low, gonna make it fertile ground. I can tell from here on, you guys are all right, but you people back here, yeah, I know you're sitting there saying, if that song could change the world, I wouldn't sing that song. But you hate gardens. There's a lot of people in the area. There's a lot of people all over the world that hate gardens. They all moved here and come to the show tonight and sat all in this section. It's all right. Guy come up to me just a few days ago. He hated gardens too, felt just like you. He handed me a verse and said, here, sing this. Okay. I'll sing it for you, because everybody needs inspiration in the world. If I can remember it. Just glanced at it once. Let's see. Slug by slug, weed by weed. Boy, this garden's got me teed. All the insects come to feed on my tomato plants. Sunburnt face, skinned up knees. I hate this next line. The kitchen's choked with zucchinis. I'm shopping at the A&P's next time I get the chance. Inch by inch, row by row, gonna make this garden grow. Gonna mulch it deep and low, gonna make it fertile ground. Inch by inch, row by row, please bless these seeds I sow. Please keep them safe below till the rain comes tumbling.
One more time for America.
Ripping up highway, I saw above me an endless skyway. I saw below me a golden valley. This land was made for you and me. This land is your land, and this land is my land. From California to the New York Island, from the River Forest to the Gulf Stream Water. It now. I remember because I was in the sixth grade and we moved, so I had to change sixth grades. And I went into the new sixth grade, and it was all singing this song. And I was the only one there that didn't know all the words. Nobody had ever told us kids that our dad's songs were sung outside the house. When you're a kid, you don't think of stuff like that. So I ran home crying. I learned the words to the song. While I was there, my dad taught me some other verses that weren't in the school book version. Some of my favorite ones go something like this. As I went walking, I saw a sign there. And on the sign it said no trespassing. But on the other side, it didn't say nothing. That sign was made for you and me. This song all over, everywhere. As a matter of fact, when I was walking off the Farm Aid stage, I said to myself, Arlo, it's too bad you didn't get a chance to sing that This Land Is Your Land song. But maybe it was a good idea anyway, because maybe this land ain't your land and my land anyhow. Because if it was, we could take it with us instead. And so I started thinking, Arlo, Arlo! Isn't it weird how the problems all them farmers were having wasn't because they didn't know what they were doing so much. It was just because they were doing it so well it wasn't worth nothing. I said to myself, Arlone, Arlone, isn't that strange how you can have a country whose problem is they got too much of something, and how an ocean away you can have a half a continent filled with people that ain't got enough of it. I said to myself, Arlone, Arlone, you got chromosome damage and everything. But if you could think of that stuff, it can't be long before a politician could. And then I said to myself, Arlone, Arlone, you've been everywhere in the world singing that song, This Land Is Your Land. But everywhere you go, you got to change the words, because they sing this song everywhere, they really do. But they have to change the words everywhere, because California to the New York Island don't go so good everywhere. I started thinking, just because it says California to the New York Island, don't mean it has to go in a straight line. It could go around the back way. Just because it says Gulf Stream Waters in Redwood Forest don't mean it has to go up and down. It could go around the back way too. And then the whole world could be singing that song. Except America. And then I said to myself, Arlone, Arlone, how come you're thinking so much anyhow? You don't know any more after thinking than before you began. I never let it stop me, though, friends. If I'm here tonight to say anything at all to you, it's I hope it never stops you neither. This is my favorite verse. Nobody living can ever stop me as I go walking my freedom highway. Nobody living. Interrupting this song, let me introduce the folks in the band to you. Starting over here on my right, a singer that lives out here is helping us out for a few shows, Rachel Gladstone. On the bass behind me, Dan Zalika. On the drums, the unbelievable Terry Oliveri. On the guitar, right on this side of me, Bob Williams. Synthesizers behind me, that's my son, Abe Guthrie. It's been real interesting twirling around up here with you tonight. Thanks for coming. Stay tuned for John Prine. It's a wonderful show. Help us sing this out of here. This land is your land. And this land is my land. From California to the New York Island. This land is your land, and this land is mine. we've got time for some of them long ones tonight. Wait for another night when we're doing the show ourselves or something. And luckily, some of them things are still available on records and stuff. We even got some new stuff out, so if you're interested, there's somewhere around here, we got them, I don't know. Some of the new stuff we can't, I'm afraid to do even live. It's too weird and strange. And not only that, I don't remember them. Let's do this here. I was standing by my own window on a cold and a cloudy day when I saw that hearse come rolling home to carry my mother away. Will the circle be unbroken?
Just thought I'd never say she's as pretty as a queen. has perfect eyes and angels from above. If she'd only be my wife, I'd have been happy all my life. But that I ain't the man you love. I asked her if she'd await me in the bar, but she only turned away, and nothing would she say. That I ain't the man in view, you know. So just thought I'd let her say, she's as pretty as a queen, she's as perfect as an angel from above. If she'd only be my wife, I could have had it all my life. But that I ain't the man in view, you know.
Thank you. Thank you. Well, I could be happy as a sardine in a can, just as long as I got man. Yeah, I could run stark naked or live in an old oak tree, just as long as she's with me, my woman. The cannibals could catch me and fry me in a pan, oh, just as long as I got man. Yeah, I could get the electric chair for a phony rap, but just as long as she was sitting in my lap, my woman. I'd run her mouth just to see her smile and put her loving arms around my neck. Torture me and stretch me like a rubber band, just as long as I got my woman. Yeah, I could jump off a cliff and never have no fear, just as long as she is near. Thank you.
Well, you're everywhere tonight, aren't you?
This is a song here I wrote with a fellow named Donnie Fritz. Funky Donnie Fritz plays piano for Chris Christopherson. He's a major character, and he's been in some movies too. They like to put him in westerns because he looks good and standing in the background. They call him a leaning man from Alabama because he stands around at 45 degree angles with his head cocked back. He doesn't talk a whole lot, so the more you talk to him, the more stupid you feel. We've been, me and Donnie have been threatening to write a song together for about 15 years. And about 5 years ago, both of us moved to Nashville around the same time, so we didn't have any excuses left. We decided we was going to write this song like the professional songwriters in Nashville do it. We were going to write it at 10 a.m. on a Monday morning. We decided on this one particular Monday, and we was going to write it in the garage at Donnie's house. And I had to go to New Orleans that weekend before that to play a show, and I told Fritz I'd come back with some sort of idea for the song so we'd get started right at 10 a.m. prompt. So on the plane back to Nashville, I was reading the National Enquirer. because I get a little nervous when I fly, and the choir makes me feel a little closer to God. This particular issue of the Enquirer was kind of low on gossip and high on unusual diseases of the world. I ran across this picture of this little girl. She's about 5 or 6 years old, and she had that disease where she had the body of a 92-year-old woman. And the caption was the oldest baby in the world. So I cut the caption out and took it over to Fritz's house the next day and said, "Look here, Donnie," I said, "the oldest baby in the world." I said, "We know a mess of old babies in this world. We ought to write a song for all of them." She's got the mind of a child and a body peeking over the hill. Well, she would if she could, and she should, but nobody will. With her nails painted red and her hair so unnaturally curled, well, I think that she may be the oldest baby in the world. She's tasted the night life, but it left her with nothing but hunger and all the available men. Seem to think that they want something younger. But youth is a costume, and the beauty within lies on fur. And I think that she may be the oldest baby in the world. Past horses win a race, rough fleshes beat aces, and everyone's playing to keep. So let's turn out the lights and rock that old baby to sleep. She loves the sound of the rain, but you know she's still afraid of the thunder. She keeps her head full of hope, and her heart is so full of wonder. She may look like a woman, but she's still some daddy's little girl. And I think that she may be the oldest baby in the world. Yes, I think that she may be the oldest baby in the world. Thank you. My partner here. We've been playing together off and on for about 5 years. He's been out playing with the Everly Brothers lately, but he's back with me now. From Dublin, Ireland, this is Philip Donnelly.
Thank you very much.
Small town, bright lights, Saturday night. 10,000 food halls are flashing their lights. You can change behind a counter in a penny arcade. Sat the fat girl daughter of Virginia Ann Ray. Lydia, Lydia here, her thoughts like a cat. Behind her small eyes, sunk deep in her fat. She read a romance magazine up in her room. It felt just like Sunday on Saturday afternoon. But dreaming just comes natural, like a first breath from a baby, like sunshine feeding daisies, like the love getting deep in your heart. Thank you.
Saturday night, a warehouse of strangers with 60 white lights, staring through the city, just wanting to be little one of too many, a young PFC. Donald, there are spaces between Donald and whatever he said. Strangers had forced him to live in his head. He'd envision the details of romantic scenes after midnight in the stillness of the back of the train. But dreaming just comes natural, like the first breath from a baby, like sunshine feeding daisies, like love hidden deep in your heart. Love, cold love, no love at all. A portrait of Gil is hung on the wall. Nothing is wrong and nothing is right. Donald and Lydia made love that night. Love. They made a love in the mountains. They made a love in the streams. They made a love in the valleys. They made a love in their dreams. But when they were finished, there was nothing to say, 'cause mostly they made love from 10 miles away. But dreaming just comes natural, like the first breath from a baby, like sunshine feeding daisies, like the love hidden deep in your heights.
Thank you.
Well, feelings are strange, especially when they come true. But I had a feeling that you'd be leaving soon. So I tried to rearrange all my emotions. But it seems the same no matter what I do. A blue umbrella rests upon my shoulder and I hide the pain while the rain makes up my man. Oh, well, my feet are wet from thinking this thing over. And it's been so long since I felt the warm sunshine. Just give me one good reason, and I promise I won't ask you anymore. Just give me one extra season, so I can figure out the other four. Makes me wonder why you left me. And nighttime makes me wonder what I said. And next time all the words I'd like to plan on. But last time was the only thing you said. And blue umbrella rests upon my shoulder. And hide the pain while the rain makes up my man. Oh, well, my feet are wet from thinking this thing over. And it's been so long since I felt the warm sunshine. Just give me one good reason, and I promise I won't ask you anymore. give me one extra season so I can figure out the other four. Thank you.
This is a song here from an album I cut a couple of years back called Bruised Orange. I guess this song is a result of watching too many reruns of Mayberry. It's Fish and Whistle.
I've been thinking lately about the people I meet. The car wash on the corner and a hole in the street. The way my ankles hurt with shoes on my feet. I'm wondering if I'm gonna see tomorrow. Father, forgive us for what we must do. You forgive us and we'll forgive you. We'll forgive each other till we both turn blue. And we'll whistle and go fishing in the other. But I never dug a trench. Used to bust my knuckles on a monkey wrench. I go to town and drink. They have the girls a pinch. I don't think they ever even noticed me. Father, forgive us for what we must do. You forgive us and we'll forgive you. We'll forgive each other till we both turn blue. Give a whistle and go fishing in the river. Fishing and a whistle, whistle and fish. Everything to put on your dish. When we get through, we'll make a big wish that we never have to do this again. Again, again. Oh, my very first job, I said, thank you, please. And then they scrub a parking lot down on my knees. Then I got fired for being scared of bees. They only give me 50 cents an hour. Father, forgive us for what we must do. You forgive us. We'll forgive each other till we both turn blue. Get a whistle and a fish in the air. Let's go fishing, homie. Fish and a whistle, a whistle and fish. You need everything to put on your dish. When we get through, we'll make a big wish that we never have to do this again. Again, again. Oh, Father, forgive us for what we must do. You forgive us, we'll forgive you. We'll forgive each other till we both turn blue. And we'll whistle and go fishing in the heaven. We'll whistle and go fishing in the heaven. We'll whistle and go fishing in the heaven. Thank you.
has something up her sleeve. Well, she danced around the firing, and she did the hoochie too. Yeah, she sang her song all night long, telling me what to do. Blow up your teeth, go away your face, go to the country, build you a home, play in a little garden, eat a lot of peaches, try and find Jesus. I'm here. Well, I was young and hungry and about to leave that place. When just as I was leaving, there she looked me in the face. I said, you must know the answer. She said, no, but I'll give it a try. And then it's very gay, but then living our way, there's the reason why. We blew up our teeth, blew our face, went to the country, built us a home. Had a lot of children, sent them on peaches. They all found Jesus on their own. Yeah.
Thank you.